Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so we will start. So I'm very pleased to chair the next tutorial session, which will be given by John Langford. So John is well known among us for his work on both theoretical aspect and practical aspects. So after getting his PhD at CMU, he has traveled around quite a bit, both in academia and in the industry, and now he's at Microsoft Research in New York. And today he's going to talk about learning to interact. John.
Thank you, Francis. Okay, so the slides are here if you want to download them yourself. And then I'm gonna be doing a demo partway through, so you can, if you download the slides, then you can see what else you need to download if you want to do it as well. Okay, so this is about learning to interact. This is one of my favorite topics because it has altered the way that I think. It's pretty cool when your research changes the way that you think. Let's see. Okay, so here's an example of interaction. So maybe a user comes to Microsoft, and that user has some history or some location, many other features, and now you want to choose some information to present. Maybe this is a URL, maybe this is a news story, maybe this is an ad, maybe it's one of many different things. And then after you choose something to present, the user reacts to this. Maybe they read it, or maybe they click, or maybe they ignore it, or something like that. And now the goal is to kind of interactively choose the right content. That's the general goal. So we're trying to learn to interact directly. Okay, so that's a particular setting. And of course, Microsoft is one of many companies which are interested in this kind of learning algorithm. All right, so here's an entirely different setting. Suppose you want to cure cancer. Right? Or maybe suppose you want to cure any disease. A patient comes to a doctor, and the doctor makes various observations, and the doctor chooses some treatment. And based upon this treatment, the patient responds. And so here it's saying, whoa, way too much information. So now the goal here is to choose some treatment for patients based upon observations, right? And this is the same problem at a mathematical level, right? So we can both cure cancer and try to sell ads at the same time. Okay, so by the way, if you have questions during the tutorial, you should feel free to ask it at the time. Questions are good. Okay, so let's start to formalize this. This is a contextual bandit setting. So if you're familiar with bandits, then if you get rid of all the red, you have the bandit setting. This is a contextual bandit setting. And the reason why we're setting the contextual bandit setting is essentially because the bandit setting is too simple, right? So if you ignore... Okay, so in the contextual bandit setting, what happens is you're interactively making some observations, getting some features and some context, and then you're going to choose some action, and then you're going to observe a reward associated with that action. If you remove the context, then you have the bandit setting. And in the bandit setting, This is a very well-studied setting with a lot of different solutions. It can work, particularly in situations where you have slot machines. That's what the bandits come from. But it's almost always the case for any decision that you want to make that there is relevant site information of one sort or another. And that means that in practice, anytime you would really hope to win, maybe you don't hope to win with the slot machines, but anytime you would hope to win, you want to be taking into account context information, and that means we need to have that in our model. Okay, so now our goal is going to be learning a good policy for choosing actions given contexts. And then the question is, how do we do that? You can go more complex, of course. You can have more complex models. You can have reinforcement learning. There's something, I think, kind of magical about this particular model, because it allows us to incorporate all of this context information effectively, while if we go just a step beyond this, we don't know how to do it. So this is sort of the most complex problem, where we know how to incorporate context information well, and also the most general problem, in the sense that it's simple enough that it applies in many different settings. Okay, so let's start with just evaluation. How do you even know that you have a good policy in a setting? So a policy is something which maps features to an action. And how do we even know that we have a good policy? So we go back here. We have this kind of interactive system going on. Maybe we can just freeze our policy, and then given X, we can just choose A, and then we can try to just evaluate what happens. Right? And that's the baseline. So the best way to evaluate a policy, in some sense, is to just deploy it in the real world and observe what happens. Okay, so now this is a great idea. I mean, it's very effective in terms of measuring things, but it has a drawback, and the drawback is that it's very expensive. And this comes up in several different ways. But imagine that you wanted to try to do medicine, right? You wanted to come up with a better method for treatment. Well, just deploying it in the real world is going to be potentially very expensive, especially if you made a mistake, right? Expensive meaning deaths, right? So you would like to be able to avoid deaths. That's important. And now the question is, how do you do that? Okay, so now, Let's think about how we would try to learn a policy. And is there a question?
How does the, what we had on the previous slide, how does the temporal component connect?
Yeah, so let me back up a little bit. So the key difference between this setting and reinforcement learning is that we know that this reward is associated with that action, right? If we did not have that association, then we would be in for a world of hurt in terms of what we could prove. So the difference between what you can prove for general reinforcement learning and what you can prove for contextual bounded settings is pretty enormous. So in reinforcement learning, the best theorems that we have a dependence upon the number of states, which is essentially a state here would correspond to an observation. The theorems that we can prove for the contextual bounded setting have no dependence on the number of observations. Right, so big win. Are there other questions? Okay, so if you're coming from supervised learning, you immediately know that you think that you know the answer. And the answer is, we're going to take a look at our past data for learning a policy, and we're going to learn a reward predictor. We can use regression to learn a reward predictor. And then we're going to act according to the argmax. Right? This seems like a sane thing to do until you actually look at what really happens in practice. So here's a very simple setting. Suppose that we're gathering data. So we have some method for gathering the data. And that method, the deployed policy, always takes action A1 on features X1, and it always takes action A2 on features X2. Okay, so we make some observations. We observe that when X1 comes up and we play A1, the average reward is 0.8. And when X2 comes up and A2 is played, the average reward is 0.2. And now we can try to build some sort of predictor based upon this, maybe something linear, I don't know. And it might give us this answer. It might say, well, I predict that the reward when you play A1 for X2 will be 0.5. And I predict that the reward for X1 when you play A2 will be 0.5. It's a very natural, reasonable prediction to make, because that's just the interpolation of the two possibilities, right? And then we're going to do this argmax, so we could say, oh, well, I'm going to deploy this in practice, and I'm going to see what happens. And so you deploy it in practice, and now you observe that the average reward when you observe X2 and play A1 is 0.3. Right? Because so the reason why we played A1 for X2 was because 0.5 is greater than 0.2. Okay, so that's nice. And then you can build a further regression based upon this. This is actual numbers that I get from running BW. Okay, so now you're in a stable state because you're always going to play A1. And then you lost, because the truth was 0.8 as we observed, it was 0.3 as we observed, it was 0.2 as we observed, and it was 1 as we didn't observe. Right? So there's many different variants of this very basic setup, which will annihilate any objections that you can come up with. So what does this mean? This means that generalization alone is not sufficient, right? So we were predicting well most of the time, except I think we didn't predict well here, but even if we had predicted well here, it wouldn't help us because we'd still be playing as we were and not observing this. So there's a fundamental difference in this problem from normal supervised learning in that you must do exploration, right? So generalization alone just can't do it. You need to have exploration to succeed. Okay, and then sometimes when I talk to people, they say strange things. They say like, okay, so we're going to do exploration, but I'm not going to worry about it. Instead, what I'm going to do is have mistakes in my prediction algorithm. That doesn't work either. Sometimes erring in which what you predict in an uncontrolled fashion is not going to give you the kinds of solutions that you really want for these problems. Okay, so this is the direct method. It doesn't really work. And now we're going to talk about some things that work. So the tutorial is in two parts. The first part, we're talking about using exploration, and we're going to be using exploration both for the purpose of evaluation and the purpose of optimization. Right, and then the second part of the tutorial is going to be about how we actually do exploration. What is the best way to do exploration so that we can kill the fewest people or avoid losing too much revenue? Either way you want to think about it. Okay, so the simplest technique to fix things is importance weighting. So we have a policy, which maps features to actions, and we want to evaluate it. We're back to just the evaluation problem. So we can collect T exploration samples, where the T samples have features, an action, a reward, and the probability of choosing the action. So we're going to be thinking about randomized exploration, where you're randomizing which action you're taking. And now we want to try to figure out how to evaluate a policy. We can look at the average over our samples of the reward times, this is the indicator function of pi of x equals a. So and then we're dividing by the probability of the action. So another way to say this is you have a policy that you want to evaluate here. When it happens to agree with the randomly chosen action in our gathered data, we're going to do some hocus pocus. So if we have a large reward, that's going to be good. And if we have a small probability, that's also going to be good. So the small probability part is a little bit unintuitive. But that turns out to be the right formula. Okay, so now what can you prove about this? You can prove that for all policies you might want to evaluate, for all IID data distributions D, the value is an unbiased estimate of the expected reward of the policy. So imagine that we have samples of X and R vector which are drawn from D, and then we look at the reward of the policy's action. So this has some particular expected value, and the claim is that that expected value is equal to the expectation of our function. Okay, and now, so there's two things you want in any kind of evaluation system. You want that you can actually evaluate what you care about, which is the first thing, but you also want that to know that that you're not going to have too much of an error due to noise. And here you have to be a little bit careful. If the probability of the policy's action becomes too small, you're going to end up with relatively large errors. So one way to think about this is to say, what if I had a fixed number of actions, let's say 3 actions, and then I was uniform over those actions when I was exploring? Then P would be 1/3, so this would be like T over 3. And then if you know your supervised learning, you know that this is just like having 1/3 as many samples as far as how accurately you can evaluate things. Okay, so now I find that people don't believe this unless I tell you the proof. The proof is actually very simple, and it's pretty informative. So this is our valuation. We have an expectation over X and R vector, but and over the randomly chosen action. But we can fix the X and the R vector, and then because of linearity of expectation, if we prove it for every X and R vector, it's going to hold for any expectation over them, right? So let's just say we're only drawing the action. That's the only randomness left. So we have this expectation here. We break the expectation up into a sum over the actions of the probability of the action. And now the probability of the action cancels with the probability of the action. And then you have a sum and an indicator function which cancel out as well. So you're just left with the actual reward. Okay, so the reason why you importance weight by 1 over the probability is because the probability that you would actually match, the probability that this would actually occur, is small. Are there any questions? So this is very important because this says something that you might have doubted a few slides ago. It says that you, even though you don't observe all the rewards that you might have hoped to observe, you can still evaluate any policy. Okay. Now there's a problem that comes up in practice. The problem is often that you don't know the probability. And this is a substantial problem. So in the worst case, you're an economist, and it's not just that you don't know a probability, it's that the probability doesn't exist, because you're just looking at observational data, and you're trying to infer from this observational data something that's very delicate. And in general, that's a bit tricky. There's other ways that things go wrong in practice, which are not as harmful as just trying to use observational data. So what goes wrong when you just use observational data is that you need to know what's going on to such an extent that you can control for biasing effects, which would otherwise screw you up. When you're trying to use this at a company, things happen a little bit differently. Often, things are misrecorded. Like we randomized some actions, but then the business logic did something else. So often when you're trying to make a decision about something, like which news story to display, there's your part of the system, but then that's a little piece of the system which is treated as advice by the rest of the system and sometimes overridden, right? Business logic is a good kind of oxymoron sometimes. Okay, another way that things go wrong is we randomized some scores, but we weren't very clear on what that did to the probability of the actions. And so often when you have a machine learning system, and if you look at its guts, you're computing some predicted number and some other predicted number, and then you're just comparing them to figure out what's going on. And then the convenient way to introduce randomization is you randomize this number, right? But then what that means in terms of the probability of individual actions is a little bit less clear because it involves truncations of cumulative distributions and integrations and things like that. So in these cases, in all of these cases, you can try to do something. You can essentially try to predict the probability of the action given the features, right? And you may be more or less successful in doing so. But if you are successful in predicting the probability of the actions given the features, the same approach can work, right? So you have a new value estimator, and now because we have a p hat, that p hat can go wrong. If it goes wrong to zero, we can get, if there's ever an event where we declare it has probability zero and it actually occurs, it's going to be very bad for our estimator. So what you do to fix that is you introduce some lower bound on the probability, and that's going to introduce some bias into our estimate. Okay, and then you can prove a theorem. The theorem is very similar, except now we have this kind of bias term, where the bias term is dependent upon how poorly we estimate our probabilities. So this is a notion of, so we have our true probability of the action given the features, and then we have an estimated probability of the actions given the features. We look at the square difference, that's kind of a squared loss regret, and the square root of that divided by tau controls our bias. So I found this technique to be most useful in debugging an existing system. So when I introduce randomness and something is going wrong, often I can build a predictor of the probability of the action given the features, and then I can just see if that agrees with the stated probability that's logged, right? And if it disagrees, there must be a bug, and then you can start, hammering down and trying to figure out why there's a bug. Okay, so this lets you get away with not knowing the probability sometimes, but because there's a bias, and because it depends upon a squared loss regret, which you don't actually know, it can be a more delicate affair. Other questions about this? Okay, so let's move on. The core problem which remains is essentially variance. So we have a little bit of an issue with bias here, but the problem here is just variance. And in the best case, we still have a problem with variance, plus we have some problem with bias. So there's kind of a question about whether or not we can deal with this. And the claim is that yes, we actually can do better in general. So if you go back and you think about the direct method, where you build a reward estimator, maybe this reward estimator is not very good. But it turns out that there's a way to take this reward estimator and put it into a more complex estimator, which, even though it's not very good, makes the overall system better. Right? And that's pretty fun. So this is the new estimator. This is the double robust estimator. And now we have a reward estimator. Okay, so you recognize the RA over PA times the indicator function. You know that RA over PA times the indicator function is an unbiased estimate, right? Now suppose I have minus R hat times the indicator function over PA. That's going to be an unbiased estimate of minus R hat, right? And now I'm just adding R hat back on. So that is an unbiased estimate of, an obviously unbiased estimate of R hat. And this part divided by this times that is an unbiased estimate of minus R hat. So I've essentially subtracted and added R hat from each side. But this helps. So suppose we have some R hat, and let's look at the deviation in R hat. So you have R hat for some A and some X, and then you have the true expected reward of A given X. Right, and there's some error there. And now, in general, we could be plugging in a probability estimate as well. So the way to measure the error in the probability estimate is this way, because we're dividing by the probability, right? So we have 1 minus p over p hat. And the theorem that you can prove is that the difference between the value and your value estimate and the true expectation is bounded by big delta times little delta. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, if we're thinking about rewards which are on the range from 0 to 1, so it's pretty easy to get a reward estimate which is within 1 of the right value, right? It's also pretty easy, typically, to get an estimate of P such that the little delta will be within 1 of the right value. And then you have a little value times a little value, which gives you a littler value, and that means that you win. It means that you're closer in terms of getting to the real expectation. So this helps with the bias. If delta here is 0, then this is equal to 0 as well. And now there's a question about what this does to the variance, right? So if you look at this formula here. The variance is coming because we're dividing by the probability. That means that the range of this random variable, this part here, is relatively large. Okay, so how do we make the range smaller? We need to decrease the size of the numerator. If R hat is equal to R, then the numerator is 0. And we no longer have a variance problem. Yeah?
Is this just control variance?
Yeah, this is control.
There's often a scaling factor used there, which can look at the covariance of R hat and R.
Is a scaling factor for the covariance of R hat and R?
So R hat is more like correlated with R. You don't do as much trivia.
Yeah, that's right. So if R hat, okay. You can plug in R hat 0 and get back to our previous estimator, right? Now that's not going to be terribly well correlated. If you plug in R hat equals minus R, then you actually do manage to get worse, but you still will eventually converge. Still, if you do anything sane, the claim is that if you do anything sane for estimating your rewards, you're going to win. Okay, so now, so these are a bunch of methods that we've presented, and we'd like to actually test things. So how do we actually test things? And here we have a problem. So if you go and you talk to a hospital, you'll be very lucky if you manage to get a hold of data, unless you're actually an employee in some capacity. If you go and you talk to an internet company, you'll still be very lucky if you get a hold of data, unless you're data of this sort, unless you're an employee. So how do academics actually work on this? And the best approach I've found, there's a few attempts to release data sets of this sort. I haven't seen very much of this sort. An approach that I've used, which I'm not really keen on, but which is the best that I've been able to come up with, is taking a supervised data set and turning it into a contextual bounded data set. Right? So if you have some particular classification data set, you can just run through each individual sample and pick an action. And if the action agrees with the label, then you get a reward of 1, and otherwise you get a reward of 0. Right? And you can choose whatever distribution you want over the individual actions. And so this is one way to create synthetic, but hopefully not too crazily synthetic, data sets of this sort so that you can study what happens with different algorithms. Okay, so now this is a data set related to RCV1. So RCV1 is a text document classification data set. Within this text document classification data set, there's higher level categories and lower level categories. One of the higher level categories is CCAT. This is predicting CCAT or not. I'll show you what it looks like in a moment. And then this is a little program that just does this transformation up here, right? It turns it into a contextual bandit type data set. So the format that this program produces is you have an action that will be 1 or 2, you have a cost that will be either 0 or 1, you have a probability which is 0.5 because you're randomizing uniformly between two actions. And then you have a set of features, right? And the only thing that's tricky here is we're using a bag of words representation. This is the actual bag of words. I think many people are used to seeing things after they've gone through a dictionary. You can do that, of course, but I'll just be using a hash function to compute the indices that I learn with. Yeah? Yeah. Well, you don't have to do 0.5. You can choose any distribution you want because you're free to do that. But I chose 0.5 here for simplicity.
What would it like really be in real problem? Would it be like the output of a supervised classifier?
Yeah, so we'll be discussing how to get exploration data in the next part. But uniform is definitely not the way to do it. If you can avoid that. Uniform is typically the first thing that's tried because it's the easiest thing to try. What you really want to be doing is randomizing over the plausible alternatives, right? And how you define the plausible alternatives is a delicate issue. Okay, so now I have a bunch of contextual bandit data. These are X, A, R, and P quads. And so I could use all the techniques that I just discussed to evaluate a policy. But evaluation and optimization are almost the same thing. So I'm just going to go a step further, and I'm going to show you how to optimize a policy using this kind of data source. Okay, so we can learn a predictor of the reward given the actions and the features. This is what many supervised learning people would have started out with anyways. And then for each feature, we can compute a double robust estimate for each action, right? So essentially we replace the pi of x with an a prime. And now this is a number for each a prime. So this gives us a cost-sensitive estimate of the value of each individual action. Right? And then then once I have a cost-sensitive, I have a cost for each individual action, I know how to apply supervised learning algorithms to do this. There's a number of techniques available. Okay, and then we can just learn the policy using cost-sensitive classifier. So VW has these kinds of things built in, and I'm going to show you how this actually works. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so this is the data set. That's what it looks like. It's essentially the same kind of format that I was telling you before. The only thing that you'll notice is, oh, interesting. Can't quite see the edge. There. Okay. Sometimes your cost is 1, sometimes your cost is 0. Okay, so then on this data set, I have fooled around with various parameters to try to figure out how to get the best performance, and these happen to be the right parameters. So I'm going to be doing a double robust optimization over 2 different actions. I'm going to, for every pair of words that are adjacent, I'm going to create a new feature, and I'm going to allow skips of up to 4 between words. These are just things that I did to improve the performance a little bit, even if I don't have them. If I don't have them, I lose 1%, and I tend to over-optimize. All right, and then I'm using a hash function. I'm going to have 24 bits for my hash function. And then I'm going to have a learning rate of 0.25. That's half the default. It's pretty close. And then this is the data set, and I'm going to tell it to use a cache file. And now it's running, right? And I've already told you that you can get an unbiased estimate of the value of a policy, right? This is the unbiased estimate of the value of the policy. You can't quite see it over there. So this is the running average over everything. This is the average since the last estimate. So this is the average from example 89074 to 178146. Right, and now it's just running through. You can see how many examples it's seen, what the current prediction is for the example that you happen to print on, how many features there are, and then you can compute various statistics about your estimate, about the loss estimates. Okay, so it's almost done. So if I was running just supervised learning, this would be over in about 12 seconds. And we'd have about the best predictor possible in this data set. Its error rate would be about 4.5%. And now I'm running contextual bandit learning. It takes more like a minute. There's more work going on because I'm building a lot more estimators under the hood, and my error rate is slightly worse than what I would have gotten with supervised learning. On this particular data set, the reward estimate ends up being pretty good. And because it's pretty good, you almost exactly match the performance of supervised learning. Okay, so now I can go and I can change to use just importance weighting. And it runs along, and the performance here is a little bit worse because there's more variance. In fact, it's worse on the order of a factor of 2 in the data, which is exactly what the theory would predict. As in, if I had twice as much data, I would get the same performance as I was getting with a double robust approach. Okay, so I'm going to let that go. using this kind of technique, we experimented with a bunch of data sets using a double robust approach. We found that it generally was pretty effective. So there's another approach I'm not going to discuss called the offset tree. It's a direct method for learning from the contextual bandit data. It's appealing in some ways, but it seems that the double robust approach tends to work better. So the double robust here is the green line, and this is error, so you want to be lower. You can see that the green is generally performing pretty well compared to just importance weighting or compared to the offset tree. All right, so here's a summary. You can try to deploy things. Sometimes you do this in a smart way with A/B testing. That's kind of a gold standard for measurement, but also for cost. You can try to use a direct method, and you'll be blind to biases and may just not succeed, plausibly won't. Sometimes you're lucky, but I wouldn't count on it. You can use inverse probability. This is unbiased. You can use an inverse propensity score where you try to estimate the probabilities. Sometimes you have to do this, and you know, I can't fault you when you have to do it, but you should be careful when you do this because it can go wrong. And then you can use the offset tree, which we haven't really discussed. The cool thing about this is that the running time is logarithmic in the number of classes or the number of actions. And then you can use this double robust approach. And this, I think, is the state of the art for these kinds of problems. So are there questions about this part? So the cool thing here is that I've told you that something is measurable that you might have not thought was measurable. You can measure these policies that choose one reward, even though you only ever see feedback about one reward in the real environment. And that's really cool, because the ability to measure something is the ability to optimize it. Okay, let's go on. So we're going to talk now about how we actually get exploration data. Okay, so this is the contextual bandit setting again. We have features, we have an action, and we have the reward for the action that we choose. And we want to learn a good policy, but now we're going to have to be more specific about what we mean about learn. What we meant about learn was just, before it was just, get a large reward or have a small cost. What we mean now is more direct. It's going to be regret. And the reason why we need this is because we're going to be controlling this action directly as we try to gather information. And we need to know how well we're controlling it. And what it means to control things well is that we both get good reward and we get the information so that we can get even better reward in the future. So regret is going to be, so we have some set of policies. A policy maps features to actions. Regret is the maximum over our policies of the average of the reward of the policy minus the reward of the chosen action. So we're trying to maximize reward. So the maximizer of reward will be the best policy in hindsight. And then because we don't know what the best policy is in foresight, we're not going to be able to always act according to the best policy. And that means that typically regret will be a positive number. It's not required, but typically it will be a positive number that we want to minimize. Okay, so this is directly analogous to the definition of regret in online learning theory, if you're familiar with that. Okay, so now we need to think for a minute. In the last section, I just assumed that exploration was uniform random exploration. But we're not really required to do uniform random exploration or any kind of random exploration. In fact, if you think about bandit learning, if you know about bandit learning, there are plenty of algorithms there that are essentially deterministic given their observations. UCB is a very common one, which is deterministic. So what does exploration really mean at its core? And what it means is you're going to choose not obviously best actions to gather information for better performance in the future. That's the core meaning of exploration. And one way to do that is randomized. And another way to do that is deterministic. And of course, there's many different variants of each of those. So if you're doing things deterministically, you could be choosing action A, then B, then C, then A, and then B, and so forth, right? And if you think about, if you happen to know UCB, when you start out, it actually looks like this. It looks like round robin at the beginning. If we're randomized, we're going to choose random actions according to some distribution over actions. Right? It could be uniform. Maybe it's uniform at the beginning, and then it becomes non-uniform as you go on. But it's some distribution over actions. Okay, now here's the thing. I'm only going to discuss randomized. And I'm forced to do that by the theory. All algorithms in the contextual bandit setting for dealing with this problem are randomized algorithms. If you can come up with a deterministic algorithm that can be effective here, that would actually be pretty interesting. Okay, so there are no good deterministic exploration algorithms. The other thing is, we already know that when things are randomized, we can support off-policy evaluation. So we can do many of the things that we were talking about before. So it's really important in practice, because it means that you don't have to think about something before you start gathering the data. If you have gathered the appropriate data, you can come up with what you want to evaluate later. And that's, of course, much better than having to think about it first. There's another subtle effect here, which is outside the model. Here we're thinking about, if we have X and we choose A, we see the reward, and then we go to X. But the real world is not like that. The real world is one where you see X, you choose A, you see X, you choose A, you see X, you choose A, you see X, you choose A. Oh, and then, by the way, you get the reward for the first one. Right? So there's some delay in the process of observing the rewards. Right? And now the question is, how robust is your algorithm to delay? And the answer is, for randomized algorithms, it tends to be pretty robust. So we can show that the additional regret is only linear in the delay. So it's just plus the delay, essentially. Okay, so now we're going to discuss ways for doing this exploration. And there's several basic approaches. The first thing that you would think of, and the first thing that you would try in many real-world situations, is just exploring first. Right, so you do uniform random exploration for some number of time steps, and then you start with tau rounds, you choose your action uniformly, you observe your reward, and then you just keep a history, a log of what's going on. And because you know things are uniform, P is sort of implicit there. Okay, and then after this first set of tau rounds, for the next T rounds, you just choose the empirical best policy or hypothesis, right? And then the question is, what can you prove about this? Okay, so suppose all examples are drawn from fixed distribution for all D, for all sets of policies. Explore tau has this regret. Okay, so what's happening here is, for the first tau rounds, you can guarantee nothing. So a tau over t fraction of the rounds, you could have large regret. And then for the remaining rounds, you can estimate a good policy to within this precision. So you can estimate a policy which is optimal up to this amount. Right. Okay, so this is the proof. It's just doing what it said. You add up the tau rounds of regret at the beginning. You estimate the quality of your solution after you have tau samples. It's going to be this quality. And then you divide everything through by big T. And then you have your regret bound. And now the question is, what is the right value of tau? Good try. It's not actually 1/4. It's a fun one. The optimal tau is 1/3. A t to the 1/3. So if you optimize tau so as to minimize your regret, you're going to choose tau equal to big T to the 1/3. There's some extra factors in there, but you essentially choose tau equal to this, and then your regret is twice tau. Okay? So this is a very simple proof. You shouldn't doubt it because it's there. You can verify it very easily. This is the easiest approach you could try. It's nice. It has some drawbacks. It doesn't adapt when the world changes. So far we've been mostly thinking about the situation with where the world's stationary. We're just having independent draws from round to round. The real world is often not stationary. And the only question is sort of on what time scale do you worry about the non-stationarity? Under-exploration is also common. So if you think about what goes on with a clinical trial, it often ends up looking something like a tau-first approach, because you have some clinical trial, and then a new treatment either passes or not, and then it goes out to the rest of the population, and you're just kind of exploiting the best. Right. Okay, so then the question is, can we do better? Yes, we can. Another approach is called epsilon greedy. This is an approach that's very common in reinforcement learning, but it applies here as well. You can just mix together your exploration and your exploitation. So with probability 1 minus epsilon, you're going to act according to your current best approach. So you're going to act according to our current best policy. And then with probability epsilon, we're going to be uniform random over actions. And in each case, we actually gather some data. So there's a trick here. Often when you think about epsilon greedy, you think about only the epsilon rounds as being useful for learning. But if you plug in things appropriately here, you can actually take advantage of your 1 month epsilon rounds as well. That's useful. It effectively doubles the amount of exploration information that you have. Okay, so if you're doing epsilon greedy, you can prove this has a regret of epsilon plus square root of number of actions times log number of policies divided by t epsilon. And then you can optimize the epsilon, and again, you get the same term. Okay, so maybe our regret wasn't any better, but maybe things are better. So this is a little bit harder, but it's not dramatically harder. The only reason why it's harder is because you're mixing together the exploration and the exploitation. So it's a little more complex to implement. It adapts when the world changes. That's a big win, right? So if things change, like maybe your news story becomes obsolete, that happens. Things change, and you start recommending other news stories. Over-exploration is common. So what I mean by that is you just keep on exploring bad possibilities, even though they've been ruled out by any sane person looking at the data carefully. Okay, so now the question is, can we do better? And the answer is yes, we can still do better. So there's this epic greedy algorithm, which is essentially a variant on epsilon greedy, where at every time step, you have some empirical performance known. So essentially what's going to happen is we're going to keep track of the error in our estimate of the value of a policy. That's going to be an epsilon sub t. So we don't have a fixed epsilon, we have an epsilon sub t. And then it's going to look the same as epsilon greedy, except we're going to have a varying epsilon, right? So with probability 1 minus epsilon, we're going to act according to our best existing policy. And with probability epsilon, we're going to act uniform randomly. And now the algorithm is self-optimizing. We don't have to ask what is the best value of epsilon. It just gives us the risk of regret. And unfortunately, it's no better. Right? It's the same kind of regret structure as we had before. Okay, so this is essentially a self-tuning version of epsilon greedy. That's nice. It's a little bit harder to implement because you need to understand what your errors are in your estimates. But it adapts, and it avoids either under or over exploration, right? So that's nice. But we're kind of frustrated, right? Because if you look at the analogous kinds of theorem statements from supervised learning, this is what you get. It's you have a dependence on log number of policies divided by t to the 1/2 power, right? And here we're stuck. We have this number of actions times log number of policies over t to the 1/3 power. Yeah? So I can't quite hear what you're saying. You're asking if you can apply the algorithms in an in-time fashion? Right. Okay, I see. So if we go back to here, in order to optimize this epsilon, we need to know t. Right? And that's annoying, because in practice, you just have this stream. You don't know how long the stream is going to be. Or in order to optimize this tau, you need to know t, and that's annoying, right? That's absolutely right. For epic greedy, you're choosing the epsilon sub t based upon your current estimate of how much error you have in between your current policy and your best policy, right? And that doesn't necessarily require that you know big T. So this can be an anytime algorithm. Okay, so there's sort of two mind-altering parts to this lecture. One of them is, yes, we can actually evaluate policies. And the other one is, yes, we can actually do better than this. I'm going to try to explain carefully how you can do better than this. So this is the simplest algorithm I know of to explain which does better than this. This is policy elimination. So policy elimination is a little bit more complex than the others. But at the end, you get a square root. You get a 1/2 power rather than a 1/3. And that's very powerful. So suppose you have 1,000,000 samples, right? That means that you have a factor of 10 less cost to your exploration. That's between a 1/3 and a 1/2 power at 1,000,000, right? So if you're measuring things in dollars, that matters, but if you're measuring things in lives, maybe that matters even more. Okay, so we have some initial set of policies, and we're just going to compute this mu t. So k here, I didn't explain this. K is the number of actions. So just think about number of actions whenever you see k. And now 1 over the square root of the number of actions times little t is going to be a little number. And then we have an empirical reward estimate, which we've formed for our policies based upon all previous observations. So for this part, refer to the first half of this lecture, right? And then for each time step, we're going to choose some distribution p over our remaining set of policies, such that for every remaining policy pi, the expected variance of the value estimate is small. Right, so we can bound the variance by something like 1 over the probability of the policy's chosen action. We want to make sure that the variance is not too large for the remaining policies. This is a policy elimination algorithm, but that means that at the end we're going to be periodically chopping away policies from the set of plausible policies. Okay, so we've choose this p, and then we observe features. We're going to draw a policy from this P, and then given the policy, we're going to choose some, given and the features, we can choose an action. So our distribution over actions will be the projection of the distribution over policies onto a distribution over actions using X. Yeah? So for this, for the analysis here, I'm assuming that the reward, the stationarity and independence, so IID essentially, from round to round. There's, that can be relaxed, but the algorithm becomes more complex. Okay, so now we choose our action according to this projected P, and then we're going to observe a reward, and then get based upon the X, the A, the R, and the P, we're going to update our understanding of the policies with our reward estimates, and then that's going to allow us to throw away some policies. Okay. So that's what's going on at a high level. And now let me show you what's happening at a more specific level. Okay, so we're going to choose a distribution P over our remaining set of policies such that for every policy remaining, the expectation over our unlabeled data of 1 over, okay, so this is a little bit complex. So here's where mu comes in. We're going to have a lower bound on the probability of exploration. And then we're going to have the probability that a random policy drawn from P agrees with the action chosen by pi. So there's something really fun happening here, because if you just treated each policy as an action, which is the valid thing to do, you would get a radically worse performance. Instead of having a logarithmic in the number of policies, you would just have a number of policies here. And that would be terrible. it's this right here is what allows us to get that log. Because when we are going to draw a pi prime, and that pi prime happens to agree with pi, it's as if we drew pi. So we get to share every policy choosing the same action gives us information. Or we get information about every policy choosing the same action. So it's the fact that the policies are bottlenecked through a small set of actions, which gives a lot of power. Okay, so this is something like 1 over the probability of the policy's action, with a few caveats. And we want to make sure that this is bounded by 2k. K is the number of actions again. Okay, so you should have a question here. Who has the question? What's that?
Can we always do that?
Exactly. Can we always do that? That was a real stumper for me. Can we always do that? It's not clear that this is even feasible. This is a bunch of constraints. We could declare any set of constraints. It doesn't mean that they're going to be feasible. It turns out that you can do that. And the proof is it the first time I've ever used Minimax in real paper. Okay, so the projection onto the distribution over actions is here. So we have the probability that the randomly chosen policy chooses a particular action. That's straightforward. And then we have another step here. So we have our previous set of policies. We have our performance estimate for a policy. And we want, so we look at the performance estimate of the best apparently performing policy in our set. And then we subtract off something. And if we're above the threshold, we keep it. And if we're below, we throw it away. So what this corresponds to mathematically is we're essentially computing a lower bound on the performance of the best policy. And then anything with a upper bound of performance above the lower bound, we end up keeping. That's what's going on under the hood. Where? A question. So I didn't quite catch the first question. So if we ever throw out the best policy, then this is not going to be a good algorithm, right? So using bound arithmetic, you use bound arithmetic to avoid throwing out the best policy. And then what was the other question? So intuitively what this accomplishes is, let's go back, let's see, I don't know how I should do this. You remember back when we were discussing importance weighting, but I went over the probability. And said that the deviation bound is driven by 1 over the square root of t times the probability. So if p becomes too small, you lose. So that means that if 1 over p becomes too large, you lose. Right? Now, the thing which is delicate here is that we have a distribution over x as well, right? And so we care about the average induced variance, which is what this is expressing. Okay. So the picture that you should have is that you have a set of policies that you start with. And initially, they each have a big confidence interval from 0 to 1. And then over time, they start narrowing in. And at every time step, you cut away the ones which you have proved could not be the optimal policy, the ones whose upper bound is less than the greatest lower bound. You just keep on running forward doing that, and it all works out, right? Well, okay, so you run forward doing that, but you have to make sure at every time step that the distribution on your remaining set of policies does not induce too much variance in their estimates. So you have a set of policies you care about. For those, you control the variance. You have a set that you don't care about. For those, you don't care about their variance. And then you just keep running forward. That set gets narrower and narrower and narrower over time. And at the end, you can prove this kind of regret guarantee. Yeah? Yeah.
Policy is a vector.
Yeah.
So in that case, when you go from IT minus 1 to IT, which operation actually do you do when you set a vector?
Yeah.
And if that's like a hyperplane or something, how do you keep track of IT as a vector?
Yeah. So you're getting at something very important here. So you're asking what happens when pi is your set of linear models. Okay, so naively, you can say, oh, this doesn't apply because pi is infinite, but that's a cop-out. Because anytime you have these floating points, you can always discretize them, and then the theorem applies. And it doesn't even matter how crudely you discretize, because that's a log, and log is an extremely powerful operation. So obviously you could try to enumerate all possible linear predictors up to some precision. And then you could just run this algorithm directly, right? Not very practical at all, because the running time is essentially linear in the number of policies. So then what do you do? Okay, so I'll get to that in a moment. Were there other questions about policy elimination? Okay. So this doesn't adapt when the world changes. We have the drawback again. This gives you much more efficient exploration. That's potentially very powerful. This is a much harder approach because of the concern you had, right? How do you actually implement this with a real set of policies? Okay, so there's more here. This drawback can be dealt with. There's an adaptive version called EXP4. This is actually the first algorithm of this sort. And it's based upon a different kind of analysis. But it can adapt to the changes in the world. There are more efficient versions of policy elimination, but this is more efficient in the theoretical sense. So this randomized UCB algorithm is extremely complex, and it has a running time which is poly in log number of policies. Okay, so it's a lot better than linear in the number of policies, but it's not yet practical because the poly is like 12th power. So now the question is, can you do better than this? You can prove a lower bound. You can say, for all algorithms, there exist problems imposing regret like this. Okay, now if you're familiar with supervised learning, this is the same kind of statement as in supervised learning, except we have a dependence on the number of actions. So that part is unremovable. The square root is achievable. It's achieved by policy elimination. It's achieved by EXP4, and it's achieved by this randomized UCB. So I don't want to give you the sense that this is not just theory here. And the reason why is there's many different sources of policies. One source is a machine learning algorithm. Another source is you get 10 people in a room, you come up with 20 ideas, and then you want to try them, right? And when you have 10 people coming up with 20 ideas, this is a very practical algorithm that you could run. The benefits will not be as dramatic because log of 20 is not so dramatic. But if you have a reasonable number of policies that you're getting from various sources, you can still imagine having substantial benefits here. Okay, so we can't do better in terms of a general analysis. You have a question? Say again? Yeah. Can you get a distribution dependent bound? Okay, so with normal banded analysis, one thing that you can do is you can look at the gaps in the performance of the different choices, independent of context, and then you can have a theorem which depends upon the gaps in those choices. You can do the same kind of thing here, but typically there aren't big gaps when you have a large number of policies. And so the meaningfulness of doing that kind of thing is less. Okay, so there's another approach called Thompson sampling. This is something which makes the Bayesian people happy because it pays. And the idea is that you maintain a Bayesian posterior over policies, and then on each round, let me back up a little bit. This is kind of the limits of theory right now. Thompson sampling is better in the sense that it's known to work well empirically. And now I'll try to explain exactly what it does. All right, so it's Bayesian. Bayes people feel happy. You maintain a posterior over your policies. On each round, you sample some policy from the posterior, and you act according to it. That's the basic idea. So you just, it's like, oh, I have a posterior. Posterior is a distribution. Let's just say that's my exploration distribution, and then act according to that. Okay. Yeah? What's that? It's a posterior on policies. So you're imagining that the world is acting according to one of a large number of policies. You have some prior on that set of policies, and then you update using Bayes' law to get a posterior on the policies. Yeah?
Sorry, I'm still confused by that notion, because the policies aren't controlled by the world, they're controlled by you. Is your posterior, this would be the best policy?
So I don't think I want to get into a debate about the meaning of Bayes' law.
But
let's just axiomatize things. You have a distribution over policies that is always greater than equal to zero and sums to one. And now we're going to make observations, and we're going to use Bayes' law to update based upon our observations.
And what's the, if we're using Bayes' law, we must have some likelihood. What's the likelihood?
I see what you're saying. So if you have a model which tells you how the world works, you can derive from that a policy, which is the best way to act given the model. So a better way to say it is, we have a distribution, or we have a prior on models about how the world works. And then we derive from that a policy. So we're going to draw from our posterior a model. We derive from that a policy. We ask the policy what we should do given the features that we observe, and then we act according to that, right? Okay, so this is connecting the dots. Okay, and now there's a particular efficient special case, which I think is worth explaining. So in the particular special case is a multivariate Gaussian. So you have a mean zero multivariate Gaussian with some chosen variance, and then you draw your weight from your mean zero, your current estimate of the policy. And then you observe your features, you compute your argmax, and you act according to it, and then you observe your reward, and then you do an Bayesian update on your multivariate Gaussian. Right? Okay, so this is a particular approach. This is one that, since I don't have a computationally tractable, theoretically sound algorithm, I have to recommend. This is worth trying. People have observed that this works well in practice. Okay, so there are efficient special cases that are known for multiple Gaussian posteriors. This is known to work well empirically sometimes. There's a paper by Li Hong Li and Olivier Chappelle, where they investigated this in some detail. Now, there's a caveat. There's a reason why there's a gap in what you can prove. In particular, you can prove a lower bound for Thompson sampling approaches, where the lower bound has a dependence linear in the number of policies. And the flavor of that lower bound is, suppose you're uniform on a large set of policies. By policies, I mean the models which drive those policies. And suppose that one of those policies chooses action one, and all the rest choose action two. Then when you draw from your posterior, you're always going to be acting according to action two. That means that action one will be starved of any information. And so even if the policy which chooses action one is the right policy, it may take you an extremely long time to figure that out. That's the essence of this lower bound. Okay, so Thompson sampling is a technique that's worth looking at. It has some obvious drawbacks that you should be aware of and you should think about. Maybe you want to impose a little bit of extra exploration beyond what the posterior would suggest. Okay, we're just about done. So this is the current state of things as far as gathering exploration. The starting technique that people use when they're just when they're at a company and they really want to try these things, is something like Exploratile, right? And this is essentially the way that clinical trials interact with the rest of the world. There's a baseline technique, which is epsilon greedy. So if you find that this works for you, then you probably are going to want to switch to this. And then if you find that epsilon greedy works for you, you're probably going to want to switch to something like epic greedy, so that you can kind of control the amount of exploration based upon the amount of information that you have. And then there's this policy elimination algorithm, which is optimal. It's practical when you're not doing machine learning, when you're asking people for strategy and things like that. But it's impractical at the scales that we're used to in machine learning. And then something to try and look at carefully is Thompson sampling. This is sometimes excellent, and there are obvious drawbacks that you have to watch out for. Okay, so this is kind of the edge of the understood world. You can see that there's something really tantalizing about this result here and the related ones, because the statistical optimality and this computational optimality, and they just don't fit together yet. There's some further discussion on hunch.net about these topics in various posts that I've made there. Okay, so there's a bibliography. This is related to exploration or using exploration data. And then there's two pages on doing exploration in one sense or another. There's several papers I didn't have time to cover in detail. But essentially everything that you should read if you're interested in contextual Bandits, for this general notion of contextual Bandits, is there. All right, thank you.
Any further questions?
Yeah.
Two questions about Thompson sampling.
Yeah.
One, how do you handle the maximization of our actions when you are in a large continuous action space? It seems that then all the theory depends on solving the new problem. And question two is regret really the right measure to be measuring a Bayesian scheme? And in particular, can you look at regret? The right thing to look at?
Okay, so for the first question, I would ask Nando how to do this. How do you solve a Bayesian scheme where you have a large continuous set of actions to optimize over? And then I would listen to what he says. I'm not an expert on that. You're more of an expert than I am. But Thompson sampling is just Bayesian. It's just Bayes' law. It really is just Bayes' law. So whatever techniques you have for that kind of thing, you can try to apply. And I would expect some sort of approximate thing, which may work more or less well, depending upon the specifics of exactly how hard the problem really is. And then for your second question, what was your second question again? Regret. Oh, right. Is regret right for Bayes? I would say regret is right for any algorithm. Because it's what you care about. If you think about what's happening in a medical, in clinical trials, regret is dead people. I mean, you really do want to find a good treatment fast, and you want to do it in a manner which is going to be robust to statistical errors. That's essentially what regret is telling you. So the method is independent of your notion of whether or not it's a good method, right? So Thompson sampling is a method. The way to evaluate all methods, I believe, is regret. Now, there's a few caveats to that. I've talked to people in companies who do A/B testing, and they're hesitant to move to a regret framework because they like saying, I have exactly this rule running, right? And to some extent, that's a real effect because maintaining multiple policies could be expensive. But to some extent, this is not a real effect. People just need to become comfortable with randomized decisions. The reason why we have clinical trials, it may not be the best exploration strategy, but the reason why we have them is because they actually do mostly not accept bad things, right? and they mostly do prefer the better thing, right? And that's good for society at large, and that's why it's the law. And it's good for you working at an internet company or you working on any kind of interactive learning. Yeah? Yeah, so if you have a current baseline policy and you want to make sure that you're never much worse than the baseline policy, okay, so there's a cheap answer here, which is just you can throw the baseline policy into your set of policies that you're optimizing over for all of the methods for gathering exploration data. And then because we guarantee our regret is with respect to the definition of regret, let's go back. The definition of regret is over a max, and if the baseline policy is the best, that will guarantee small regret with respect to that. So this is kind of a cheap answer, and the reason why it's a cheap answer is that the ranges of regrets, depending on the specifics of how many policies you have and how many samples, the range of regrets could be relatively large. So now the question is, can you have an additional, can you guarantee small regret with respect to a specific policy? And the answer is generally yes. There are ways to modify the algorithms so that you kind of overweight a specific policy in your measurement of regret. And you make sure you don't have very much regret with respect to that specific policy. But that's a little bit delicate. You have to take the algorithms apart and see how to do that. Yeah? Yeah. So over exploitation, I would not say is quite the same thing as overfitting. I guess over-exploitation means under-exploration to me. So under-exploration means that you're getting too much regret because you're not very certain about what is the right policy. Actually, so maybe that is like overfitting in some sense. So certainly when you're overfitting, it's true that you're not very certain about what the right policy is. But there's other reasons why you might not be very certain about what the right policy is. Maybe you just don't have enough information. Right, so you control, as a machine learning person, you control both the policy space and the way that you're sampling, ideally. And now both of these are controlling that observation. Yeah? So the rewards in all of the algorithms I talked about can be some conditional distribution. So in any conditional distribution. For EXP4, which is a special algorithm, they can even be adversarially chosen. Yeah? Yeah.
Then is anything in your machinery, let's say that your robust machinery that you chose, anything is gonna change there or
So what changes if you use double robust is you can eliminate bad policies faster because you have a smaller variance. So step five here. Right? So in general our confidence intervals are going to depend upon the variance of the variables that we're taking the average of. And if double robust reduces that variance, those confidence intervals get tighter. And when they're tighter, we can eliminate bad things faster, and then we get an improvement. Now, the amount of improvement that we get is not factored into this theorem statement, because in the worst case, we don't get any improvement.
But in the policy evaluation, forget about the optimization, just the policy evaluation.
Yeah. Yeah. I see. So the fact that you have, it turns out that having it, this distribution over actions can be varying from event to event, and it's still a valid statement. And that's because the proof of unbiasedness, if we go back here, was independent of X and R. So it didn't depend upon the history. It just, it's a very isolated thing, which you should then take a linearity of expectation over. Right? There's something that you're almost getting at, which is I didn't discuss in great detail, which is when you have exploration data, you can of course evaluate a static policy, as I showed you here, but you can go one further. You can actually evaluate non-stationary policies, like a contextual managed algorithm. That's a more advanced thing. What's that? Yeah, they're not here, but there's so papers between Li Hong and me. There's like two or three papers involving Li Hong and me as co-authors and some other co-authors, and those are the appropriate papers. All right. Thank you.
Okay,